Ladies and gentlemen, I kindly ask you to take your seats. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2015 Copernicus Medal Ceremony. It is our great pleasure to honor tonight a remarkable scientist, a good friend of us, and a very nice person, Uli Pöschel. And I especially would like to welcome his family here from Austria, partly even from Wien, so welcome here tonight to honor Uli, and I especially would like to welcome Uli's friends and colleagues who joined him on this journey of the last years through science and through open access publishing. Actually, the Copernicus Medal is presented by the Copernicus EV, which is a non-profit society and the partner, the exclusive partner of the Copernicus meetings and open access publication. The Copernicus EV was founded in 1988 by scientists and directors of the Copernicus Institute, not the Max Planck Institute, for solar system research. And 2 years ago, we celebrated our 25th anniversary. And so we decided that we would like to present a medal. And last year, we honored Professor Corinne Le Carré. The idea of the medal had, in principle, two issues. The first one, we would like to honor scientists who made great achievements in the sciences, in their scientific disciplines. The second one was that we also want to outline if someone has made remarkable achievements to foster the international collaboration in the Earth and space sciences, because this is part of the mission statement of the Copernicus EV. And the third thing is that we wanted to present a medal actually for scientists in the midst of their career. So all the three things has to come together, and we had an international board of reviewers. And Meinrad André, who could unfortunately not be here, suggested Uli, and at the end, the board of referees selected Uli for this medal. So please welcome with me tonight a citationist and an old friend of Uli, Thomas Koop, here on stage.
Thank you very much, Martin, dear Uli, dear friends, dear colleagues. I'm very pleased to give this laudation to Uli's work and to the Copernicus model. So when I was invited to give this laudation, I was thinking, gee, so it's in Austria, and it's the medal is presented to an Austrian, and it's an important medal, so, you know. What does come to mind? So I had my own private brainstorming, and the first thing that I came to mind is, well, important Austrians, right? So, and of course, everybody knows him, world champion in bodybuilding and governor and Hollywood star. And the next thing that came to mind, or the next person, was skiing, downhill skier, Hermann Mayer, who was, I don't know, 2 times Olympic gold medalist, world champion, World Cup winner, and so on. And you see, slowly there's a pattern emerging. And now, but what doesn't sound right is when we say, we know Uli as Uli, of course, but in that pattern, it doesn't really fit. So let's see whether during the talk we can sort of get a better idea. So the medal is actually presented for, as you say, aerosol multiphase chemical processes and aerosol health interactions, so that's the scientific part, and also in terms of interactive open access publishing and public peer review. So I'll start with the second part first. So this idea actually was born in 2000. Well, maybe it was born a little bit earlier, but the first time I heard about it was in 2000 when I get a call by Uli. And so that was what lots of people thought a very crazy idea. So to have public peer review by reviewers, so for everybody to see. Every scientist could comment on papers, and well, this was a big problem to some people. Even rejected papers are openly archived and stay there forever. So there were lots of people initially very skeptical, but there were lots of meetings, funny meetings, like Arne was there, and intensive meetings, I maybe should say. Some of them very productive and very, very, very straightforward. Others didn't go that well. I remember a prominent English scientist after one of the meetings said, this meeting was a train crash. But he has published since then in a journal, I don't know, it's 10, 15 papers at least. So after an intense while with lots of people involved, the first papers came online in 2001. And this is actually the discussion version of the first ever paper in ACP, which is the journal that Uli founded. And there was another strange thing initially, because like people weren't used. I mean, this is a paper. I mean, just look at it. It's not a paper, right? Papers were supposed to be DIN A4 or maybe a letter size, but not landscape, right? All right, so nevertheless, it went online, and then, of course, there were lots of questions about the process, right? I'm not sure how many of you have published in any of these open access journals. I would guess maybe, I don't know, maybe the family not, but for the rest, 95% or so. And the system that now is very familiar to almost everybody at that time was really, really different. People didn't get it initially. They said, it's too complicated and I don't get it. And what really, really made it work in the end was Uli just explained it again and again and again in meetings to everybody, in open access meetings, because one part of this journal was also that it had to be open access, because how are you going to discuss if it's behind closed doors? And without the dedication and the determination Uli always showed, and because he thought it was the right idea, it is the way to go forward, he just pushed and just explained and explained and explained. And at some point, people just started understanding, and now it looks like many of you, I guess, know how it works. Well, and it works. So now today, I just looked up the numbers, so this is the journal. There's a screenshot of the journal from 2 weeks ago or so. And I just have a few numbers here from 2014. So there were roughly more than 1,000 papers received by ACP, a little bit more than 3,500 comments. In the end, we had 800 final papers, 30,000 citations in the Web of Science registry. And in terms of international, you just mentioned that, we have authors and referees really from every single continent. What is maybe special about, well, initially you think, well, if it's an open access journal, that was one of the initial questions was, if it's open access, it's bad, right? It cannot be the same quality. If there must be a price tag, otherwise it's not good, right? I mean, that's the way how we buy our smartphones and gadgets and so on. But this is different because it is a really high-profile journal. It is one of the top journals in the field with a high impact factor. But and it's one of the biggest in the field with roughly 800 papers published. And if you look at the numbers here, we have only a rejection rate of roughly 20%. So actually very, very low. So this in this combination is very unique, and it's probably due to this system that nobody wants to be ripped apart in public. So you really be careful what you send there. And this is one of the initial ideas that Uli had, and I think it works. So in total, we have 6,500 papers published. In the meantime, 15 sister EGU journals, all with public peer review, and Uli led the publication committee until last year. So he was also responsible very much for pushing that. And in terms of all these EGU journals, it turns out that this is we're one of the leaders in open access publishing. It's just together with Copernicus. All right, and as I said, I cannot repeat it as often as possible. I mean, without Uli, that wouldn't have become possible. All right, so let's get to the second part. Aerosol multiphase chemical processes. Well, not everybody here in the room is a chemist, but so I say something about the chemistry. So Uli is at the Max Planck Institute for Chemistry in Mainz, in Germany. And there he's the director and leads the Department of Multiphase Chemistry. All right, so what you're gonna do if you wanna find out something about someone? Well, you Google him, of course, right? That's what I did. So you Google Uli Pöschl and you see, you know, here, first hit Max Planck Institute profile, then the two Wikipedia pages, the German one and the English one. And then you see here, nice, this is a screenshot from Wikipedia, I believe. And there you see Meinrad André, Paul, Stefan, other directors of the Institute, a former mentor, Reinhard Meissner. And there you see Uli, and you see already, now he looks a little tired. I guess it's a strenuous job, and so sort of fitting. But then, so this is when I Googled a couple of days ago. But when I googled him at another time, this is what I found. And maybe I just get a little bit bigger. I mean, you see, everything is the same except the guy, right? I mean, it's somebody else. So now I'm beginning to think that there is, maybe there are two Uli Pöschels working at the Institute, because, you know, they're born 96, both of them, you know, both directors at the Institute. And what I'm beginning to think is that actually the Institute made a spelling mistake when they started this new department. It should be multi-face chemistry rather than, right? And so when I thought about it a little bit more, then actually, so if there are at least two people working at that same institute with the same name, right? Well, then we probably should like divide the number of publications by two and the age index by two. And if I do it, actually makes me feel personally much better when I compare. Well, anyway, so what is multiphase chemistry in reality? So this is from a paper and from several public, I think part of it will also be shown by Uli in a couple of minutes. It basically tells multiphase means different phases, and it's the gas phase, the liquid phase, the solid phase, and there's even something in between where we can't decide, so we call it semi-solid phase. And the interaction of molecules with between the gas phase and the liquid phase, or between some of these phases, and so on. And these are very, you know, on very small scales. So they are nanometer to millimeter scales. So, for example, processes occurring on soot particles or secondary organic aerosol particles. These are some of the processes. And then how chemical reactions occur at the surface in the bulk of these particles, and so on. On very, I mean, sometimes very small, so a single molecular process on a very small time scale. And one of the things that Uli is really special is, I mean, he really wants to understand the full thing, even if it's damn complicated. So sometimes these things are very complicated. So, for example, these are all the processes that you have to consider if you want to understand the chemical reactions occurring at the surface or in the bulk of such a particle. And this is a, you know, a complicated model that Manabu, I saw also here, developed together with Uli. And you know, you have all to understand all these different processes, not just qualitatively, but also quantitatively. And that makes it really, really complicated. But he doesn't shy away from these kind of questions and just say, okay, if it's that complicated, I don't care. We just look at each process by process, and then in the end, we're going to understand it. And some of these models are now really universally be applicable to many of the questions that we have. And it turns out that these processes are really also important for much larger scales. So for when you start with such particles on the, let's say, sub-micrometer range, they are important for clouds on the meter range, and then on larger scales, on the kilometer, or then even on a global scale, if you think of climate-related processes. And then there's many processes that he's also interested in, the interactions between not just the atmosphere and small particles, but also the biosphere, like cryogenic covers, the lithosphere. There are papers where gases react with soil or interact with soil, with the hydrosphere, and so on. And now I guess the next step, and that also is in the nomination already mentioned, is health issues. So if you want to understand health issues, you have to understand how cells work. And this is, I guess, some of the last things. Now my presentation has frozen. Oh, here we go. You have to understand chemistry in cells. Now, even to understand a cell by first principle, it's already very complicated, even for the biologist who is, I mean, that's their job, sort of, right? And as a chemist, he doesn't care. I mean, he just said, okay, well, there is chemistry going on, so we start, and at some point we'll do it. And this is, again, the same kind of determination and dedication that he's up to, and this is what characterized him, also in lots of discussions that we had when we had scientific papers together, which there are a few But only very recently, actually. We know each other now for 97, 18 years, and we published only for 3 or 4 years, so it took a long time. But it just didn't work out before. But now it works out quite well. Anyway, so with that, I'm closing, and maybe some of the answers could be something like, well, you can read them, right? I mean, he's certainly very determined in everything he does, so I think that would be quite a fitting name, but maybe there are others, and maybe later after the talk, after his talk, actually, during the reception, we can discuss that further. And with that, I'd like to end by expressing my sincerest congratulations to the medal for you, Uli, as a scientist, as a colleague, and as a friend. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Thomas. Now I would like to call 3 members of the Copernicus Society on stage. First, the secretary of the Copernicus EV, Arne Richter. Please come on stage. And then I would like to call the 2 initiators and also the steering committee of the medal committee on stage from the German Center for Geoscience Research, Hermann Lühr, and Professor Christian Schlegel. Okay, now I'm really honored and I'm proud and happy to present the 2015 Copernicus Medal to Uli Pöschl. Please come on stage.
Well, many thanks again, Martin and Thomas and Copernicus at large. And good evening, everybody. It's a great pleasure to receive the Copernicus Medal and a great honor. And it's an equally great pleasure, actually, to be here with you this evening and to share the award with you, actually, in a way, with everyone, and in particular, of course, with the direct collaborators. So that's very nice. To have you all here. And in order of having an enjoyable evening, I think we'll have some more drinks. I can then also have some alcoholic ones after one, in order to have some more drinks afterwards. But before that, I think we will have a little bit more of science, and it will be difficult for me to keep up in terms of entertainment with Thomas, but I still try to entertain you well with a few aspects of open access of multiphase chemistry, but pH, multiphase chemistry, and open access. So before going into the details, though, I would really like to enlarge the acknowledgements a bit further. So first of all, of course, for the Copernicus Medal, again, to the Copernicus Gesellschaft, the committee, nominators, and laudator. I couldn't have hoped for a better one, actually. I had a lot of fun. And then also with regard to multiphase chemistry, it's really essentially the whole team at the Max Planck Institute for Chemistry and a huge number, really, of partners locally and internationally. And up there, I'm actually just naming a few of the people with whom I collaborated closely recently. But again, even there, it wouldn't be possible to put everybody on the list here. So essentially, I really want to emphasize here also the many more and a few of the names you will actually see popping up later on with individual results. And then also, on the other hand, for open access, it's indeed the entire ACP editorial board, which indeed I had to somehow repeat things very often, but then it fell on fertile ground, and we did actually all together achieve this spread of open access and of the interactive public peer review. And EGU Council and the Publications Committee were all really very supportive over the very years. And then, of course, the entire Copernicus team. And also, in the end, family and friends. And there I really would like to mention also my wife, Andrea, and brother, Martin, because they literally made direct contributions every other evening, essentially, and every other weekend I spent in the years 2000 and 2001 working on the concept and so on, and exchanging with Thomas and the executive committee. But they made direct contributions there, but it's also a lot of time, actually, that they donated, but a lot of time actually also from the other people like Thomas's family and so on. They all had to donate a lot of time to our ventures, which became a big success in the end. So thanks again to everybody. And now I would just like to walk you through a few specific examples of what Thomas had already shown. So first of all, to show you how really Earth and life science converges in multiphase chemistry, atmospheric and biological multiphase processes. Then talk briefly about the interaction of bioaerosols, clouds, and precipitation. Don't worry, I'll be short on each of those. It's late already after a long day. But I still want to give you the flavor. Reactive oxygen and nitrogen species, also again at the interface of Earth and life science, and human health and allergies in the Anthropocene. Many of you might know it, but I think it's a very powerful term that we also owe to Paul Crutzen. And open access, then very briefly, Thomas said most things, I'll just mention a few things, and try to wrap up with some general conclusions on scientific research and future perspectives. And Thomas has already explained this thing with the large scaling that we are trying to cover also now in my department, but also before, also in my research group, which is a bit smaller. And the central question, maybe I should say, is really, how does multiphase chemistry, namely all these processes, how do these influence the Earth system, but also human life? And I'll try to make that a bit clearer now with some examples. But let's start maybe with what we are used to here at EGU, with this atmosphere-biosphere exchange, and where multiphase chemistry plays a role. The most obvious example are, of course, aerosol particles, by definition, liquid or solid small particles suspended in the gas, so you have multiple phases already. And the same is true for clouds. Many of us are investigating that with regard to atmospheric and climate implications, and also biosphere and human health. We know a lot about it qualitatively, but really the mechanistic understanding on the molecular level, really the reaction rate coefficients and so on, and Thomas showed already our model there, that's what we would like to pin down and then have a quantitative understanding and also single out the human influence, for example, as far as climate is concerned, or also where it is worthwhile to invest for health issues. And for those of you who are not so familiar with aerosols and particles, some are very familiar, others not at all, I guess. Just a little scale bar here from gas molecules here in the sub-nanometer range, we go then all the way up essentially to the centimeter range. And as a little yardstick here, we have bioaerosol particles. That's one of our favorite pets to investigate. And up here you can see again the general definition of aerosols, which then grow into cloud and fog droplets in the atmosphere. And on the other hand, cells and organelles are on the same scale. And that's already a good thing for interaction. If you are on the same scale, you can interact efficiently. And that's also what happens actually in both in the atmosphere and in the biosphere. These things on a molecular level, meaning nanometer, sub-nanometer, up to really millimeters and more, they do interact in similar ways, because in the atmosphere you have gas molecules interacting, in the biosphere it's a lot of molecules in the aqueous matrix, then you have molecular clusters and biopolymers, proteins are nanoparticles essentially on that scale, then you go up to aerosol particles, membranes and organelles, that sort of parts of these cells, and then you go really up to clouds and precipitation, large hydrometeors, and you also have cells and organisms on that scale. And that's the thing that Thomas showed earlier on in a different picture. We can now really describe that by mass transport and chemical reaction on all these different layers. And there are, so it's a very wide field, obviously, and of course we are focusing on a few specific aspects, but also across this wide field there are some common denominators, like we can use similar analytical techniques, we can use similar approaches of chemical kinetics. There is just one chemistry, at least with matter, with antimatter it may be different, but with matter it's of course the same chemistry, whether it's in a living organism or in the atmosphere or simply in the planet. It's always the same thing. And so this is maybe following up on the multiphase with an F on Thomas's definition of multiphase chemistry, and that's only a few phases again from the department, the group leaders with whom I started the department in 2012 now in Mainz. And essentially, you can see with Yafang Cheng, aerosols, regional air quality, Gerhard Lammel, semi-volatile organic compounds. That's sort of the main title for the fields, where you find again what I said earlier on, Manabu Shiraiva, organic aerosols and oxidants. And this upper part on the other side here, then Suhang with aerosol cloud biosphere interactions. So that's more the chemistry side of the game. And then we have trained biologists, so we try really to lift this interdisciplinarity in the department with good, or let's start over here, ladies first. And also biology is still closer to chemistry, Bettina Weber, looking at the cryptogamic covers, Janine Fröhlich, bioaerosols, microbiology, and then Kurt Lukas, that's sort of the far end, really where we try to go into medicinal chemistry and physiological processes, and I'll show you some more in these examples now, and you will see the individual names popping up. So just very briefly, about these bioaerosols. Again, some of you know it, but others might not be aware that we really have about 100 of these bacteria or fungal spores on average coming up from the ground across the continent, so that's the average value. So there is a lot of life actually going up into the air continuously. And we have in the air then some of these particles, and the stuff that we inhale, even in the fine particulate matter, is enough to be equivalent to 10 to the 8 bacterial genomes per day. Of course, we don't inhale 10 to the 8, 100 million different bacteria every day, but the total amount of DNA that we are inhaling is just a huge amount of biological information. We will come back to cryptogamic covers. When I was hiking through the through US national parks, there were often these signs, "It's alive, don't step on it," and I thought it's a joke back then, because I wasn't enlightened yet that there are these cryptogamic covers growing all over the place. And indeed, the same is actually true also for the air. It's alive because you do inhale enormous amounts of information. And of course, the body has to deal with it. Some of them are infectious or allergic. Some of it are also harmless. Anyhow, one aspect that we also look into is really the bioprecipitation cycle, whether these particles can actually even trigger the formation of rain, for example, and come back down with the water, and then they have a good opportunity to grow again because it's already wet, and they can then grow down there. So we are looking at aerosol cloud precipitation interactions at large, and in particular at these bioaerosols. And what we could show some years ago already is that actually we could then prove it, one could have thought of it anyhow, that in the Amazon region, in a pristine rainforest region, actually you don't have many other particles at all to trigger the formation of rain. Let's see whether this comes up. So you emit down here primary biological particles and volatile organic compounds that are then oxidized. And essentially the entire aerosol population is dominated by the biosphere because it's very clean. There are no other sources at certain periods of time at least. And that means that all the clouds grow on these biogenic particles, and that means there must be a bioprecipitation at work there. And the question that remains to be solved really, if this is also true on a global scale. And another question that comes up is actually, if you increase the number of particles, this is working a bit slow now, if you increase the number of particles, does that lead to an invigoration of the rainfall or to a decrease of precipitation? And well, here it is. And if you cut through this upper figure here, then you can see, well, it depends. If you have very clean conditions and you increase a little bit, the rainfall rate can increase strongly. But if you then go over a certain limit, it can decrease again. And that's, of course, the complexity in this whole climate system, why it's then also quite complex to predict climate. This is just a little piece of the puzzle, but why it's so complex also to predict climate change and the like. So that's one of the aspects here. Let me see if I can revive the mouse. Doesn't seem to work right now well. Well, and one thing, of course, you can speculate a lot, but what we did very successfully this year, and some of you may have seen the presentation given by Manfred Wendisch, was also a big aircraft campaign over the Amazon where we really want to pin these things down. So as I showed you, we have some ground measurements, we have some model predictions, and here on the right side, you can see that indeed under clean condition, you get a higher cloud, more large particles, and more rain formation more rapidly, whereas when you have a lot of pollution and there when you have biomass burning, when the rainforest is burned down to clear the land, then you have highly polluted conditions and then rain is actually suppressed. Here you can see simply the particle number concentration plotted against droplet diameter, and just qualitatively you see a difference, and we are dwelling into that. So these are very fresh data. I just wanted to show you an example. Let's go to these reactive nitrogen species. So far it was aerosol particles. Now, what are these? Actually, that's a very old concept. Ozone, of course, is one of the main things in atmospheric research, OH radicals, H2O2, and so on. But the same is actually true in physiological chemistry. It's a very old concept, reactive oxygen species in physiological chemistry. And also the same goes for reactive nitrogen species. NO is a very important neurotransmitter, actually checking how your heart works and how the veins and so on behave. And all these things play a role in both areas. And separately, actually, they have been investigated for a long time, but the actual interaction, the coupling between the two, what happens if you generate excess ozone up here, what happens on the physiological side, that's not really well known. That's qualitatively known. We know that ozone, it's not good to inhale too much ozone or too many nitrogen oxides, but it's not so well known quantitatively. And even, and I'll come to these health aspects in a minute, but even also out there on the Earth system science side, it's not so clear. So one discovery from Suhang was then that really if we have nitrite in the ground, you can actually emit from the ground nitrous acid. So the ground can emit this reactive nitrogen species. Mostly it was seen as a sink or maybe surface reactions, but it can come deep out of the ground. And then you, by photolysis, dissociate this nitrous acid molecule and make OH radicals, so also reactive oxygen species. Again, there is a tight coupling, and we are currently looking if and how these cryptogamic covers growing on the surfaces, how the surface processes really, not what happens also in the bulk, but on the surface, may further accelerate this reactive nitrogen cycle. So again, just one example, and this one I will also not dwell on so much. Thomas has shown you the upper one. Down here you can see lung lining fluid and how really ozone, for example, is inhaled, how it then diffuses in the body, and how it may then interact in there directly with antioxidant, chewing up what we have in there to protect us from the environment, or how, for example, if you inhale metal particles, they can then trigger the formation of such reactive compounds that may then really do harm to the cells in there and produce secondary toxins and the like. So that's the overview on this thing, and I now want to go more specifically really now, what do these things possibly do to human health? And in particular, one thing we are looking into, and allergies in the Anthropocene. And maybe first of all, what is the Anthropocene? Paul Crutzen defined that a bit more than a decade ago, around 2000, as a new age in Earth and human history. And I think actually that this term will hopefully help us to make progress also in this endless struggle about the climate debate, to see it also in one hand, in a warning sign, as he put it there, also if you look here at the curves of greenhouse gas emissions and how these have been rocketing up in the recent past, of course you see that somehow the Earth system is different now than it used to be. That's what triggered this term of the Anthropocene. But on the other hand, I think it also shows that yes, we are shaping the planet already. And there is a lot, of course, of science under it. I don't want to dwell on it right now. There are also lots of discussions going on. But in the end, if you look at it carefully, everybody will, in the end, agree that, yes, we are shaping the planet. If you look from a satellite, you see it immediately. We are shaping the entire surface. If you look at the atmospheric composition, you see it immediately. It's all out of the natural variability of the past million of years. And so there are also new challenges coming up that I will talk about more now with regard to human health, really. But one important thing on the climate side, and I'll not go on with the climate issue, but it's really this message that I see in there: we are shaping the planet, so let's get it right, to phrase it also a bit more positive in a sense, right? Not only let's mitigate climate change and so on, but let's shape it in a positive way. Of course, there's the very delicate topic of geoengineering and so on, but in any case, we need to understand what is going on out there and how planet Earth will evolve in the future. And I'll now go specifically to the point how this composition change in the atmosphere may affect human health with regard to allergies. And here's just some evidence that really going here from 1900 to 2000, all of these curves are just demonstrating that the ozone background concentrations, I'm not talking about summer smog, but the regional background concentrations are going up. There are different trends in different regions sometimes, but overall, it's about a twofold background increase. And then if you look at aerosols, there's really in polluted regions, you have all heard about the heavy smog in Beijing and so on over the past years, in the past decades almost already. Really the enhancement is by a factor of 10. So a factor of 2 and a factor of 10 are a lot for subtle things like biological organisms. And there are studies, actually, and it was at the Anthropocene Symposium on Paul Crutzen's 80th birthday, actually, to celebrate his achievement there, where sometimes these birthday celebrations are very nice to gain new insights from other people. And there, Jack Fishman came up with something that I had never heard of before, that there are studies that more or less clearly, it's always a bit difficult, as you always know, to prove something 100% if it's out in the environment. But it's clear that ozone is able to decrease crop yields. So, but if ozone background concentration, enhanced background, decreases the crop yields, how much comes out of such a simple plant like soy or wheat or so, how should we expect that ozone would not interfere with human health, which is an even more delicate biological organism? And so the hypothesis would be And there have been various hypotheses about why allergies, and here you can see rhinitis, that's hay fever essentially, how that has been going up in Germany over year of birth, over time. So there are quite good statistics out there by now, although hard data are always hard to find in medicinal chemistry because it's a very complex thing. But there are some hard data about it. And there are various hypotheses, whether it's hygiene, excessive hygiene, our immune system is not busy enough, so it looks for enemies that are no enemies. Is it the wrong nutrition that we have? Is it stress of any kind? Or is it pollution? And there are quite a few studies that do say, yes, epidemiological studies, there is a pollution effect, but if so, then what is actually the effect? And that's essentially totally unknown up to now. So, before we look at which chemical reaction it can be, let's see what an allergic reaction is. You have an antigen in general or an allergen, a pollen grain coming into your respiratory tract, for example, and there it hits various cells of our immune system. It's a very complex game, but essentially these circles are cells and there are various cells interacting, and all the blue arrows here and the blue names and symbols are all proteins. So these are protein molecules that interact with each other and with these cells. And the cells are semi-solid, they're embedded in liquid, so we have multiphase chemistry again. And the point is, the immune system in all these complex interactions somehow thinks that this poor little pollen grain, for example, birch pollen or so, is a bad parasite and that it needs to be fought again with reactive oxygen species, with OH radicals, ozone, H2O2, sort of all these nasty things that are not healthy to inhale. They then are released, it's a false alarm, and that actually does harm to the body. And what could trigger these false reactions? One thing that we have been looking into is protein molecules that are these nanoparticle-sized things. They can react with ozone. So we have learned that ozone has gone up over time and nitrogen oxides have also gone up. And if you put them together onto a protein molecule, you can nitrate the protein, you can add this NO2 group, or you can dimerize them, oligomerize them, make them bigger. And essentially, some of our biomedical partners have shown that, yes, this can enhance the allergenicity, but we don't know yet what are the threshold levels, at which point is ozone really unhealthy. Do we have to go back to pre-industrial times, 10 to 20 ppb to be safe, sort of, or is 30 ppb okay, or is 50 ppb really bad? That's all totally unknown, and what really also does the thing, if it's hygiene, nutrition, and air pollution, that's all still up. So that's not resolved, but we are in the middle of researching it, and I hope that we will be able to resolve it by going deeper into these cycles, where, for example, a molecule comes in, triggers such a receptor on the cell surface, then protein molecules are released, they trigger other particles, and then it goes in such cycles. And again, there is this analogy between atmospheric chemistry and biochemistry, physiological chemistry. Such cycles you also have in ozone decomposition, essentially, right? You have there's polar stratospheric clouds, and on the surface, chlorine reacts, and you get chlorine species, and they then continue to degrade ozone, and so on. You get these degradation cycles, and you have similar processes, somewhat more complex in the biological system, also going on inside our body, and we have fancy new techniques with fluorescence microscopy and so on nowadays at hand to really go after these things, and that's essentially the one thing that we are aiming at now, and we have just, for example, in Mainz now, together with the university clinics, founded a center for chemical allergology to really go after these things on a chemical level. So that's just a picture book of this kind of multiphase chemistry. No worries, it was a lot of things, but I'll come up with a one line take-home message in a minute. And before that, I'll just say a few words about open access, why we are actually doing this open access. And all the things that I have shown to you sort of are things that in the past used to be locked away behind subscription barriers, and I think it's important for us scientists, but also for the public, to have this freely available. So there are educational reasons to have free access on the internet. There are economic and technological reasons to really support it. But of course, what we care about most are the scientific reasons, and that's really, again, I fortunately don't have to dwell on it much because Thomas pointed it out. It's really this fostering of scientific discussion and peer review and to improve quality assurance. And maybe just one word to you. I've had lots of discussions about defending open access. Why do we change the old system? Well, we have to change it. And one of the main reasons why we have to change this is actually, in principle, it's a scandal that science at large actually relies entirely on subscription agencies and people who pay the money to buy all or get for free because of a monopoly or oligopoly position access to all the publications and then do the citation counting for us, then analyze how we cite each other and so on. So if you think deeper about scientific evaluation, it's crazy that we dedicate that outside, others do it for us rather than us being able to do it ourselves. And so one of the major benefits of open access will be that everybody will be able to access all the public literature out there, all the literature, and to analyze it and to see where the information flows, how it fits together, and to do all these things. It's the machine reading and all these things to generate new knowledge, but also to track it. And in the end here, I will not dwell very much, Thomas said that already, but in the end, essentially, I'm jumping down here, we want to come to an epistemic web. And that's sort of an internet that contains not all only the huge body of information that scientists have generated now over centennia, millennia already, right? If you go back in the roots and it's all exponentially growing. So it's not only the matter of fact of having free access, but also of seeing how things are related, not only what we know, but also how we know it. And all these things are essentially only possible with open access. And that's why I think we should all together really strive more for having this open access. And in an open access environment, we can then do much more. We have 14 years ago now, started to do some of that with this public discussion and so on. But we can do much more. And that's sort of, I'm coming to the end of the presentation now. If you want to know more about it, there are some nice papers all openly available, of course, on the internet, where you can dwell into it. But since I do see quite a few young colleagues also who hopefully will pick that up and will go further, and we have just started to touch into this, not only at the point of the interdisciplinary earth and life science, but also at the point of open access. So this here, these conclusions and outlook is sort of also kind of lessons learned from me on the way to here, and something that I would like to pass on where I think we should all expand upon. So these are sort of the take-home messages from this potpourri of things that I tried to show to you. So I think that really in this interdisciplinarity in life sciences, to me, actually, the grass is always greener under the fence, not over the fence, because to the fence, it's hard to come with a lawnmower, and also the cows don't come there so easily. So there is a lot of green grass under the fence between the disciplines. So I really think that there is lots of exciting research and discoveries ahead exactly at these interfaces. With regard to climate, I didn't dwell much on climate, but health is what we are going into. But I think it's particularly important for the climate discussion, for the political struggle that we are in right now. I think it's a very good opportunity to use this word Anthropocene and really say we are shaping the planet, let's go, let's do it right. And there I would really like to give special thanks again also to Paul Crutzen to have come up with yet another great idea and point there. Open access and public peer review, I hope I could show you some of the motivation in this short time of why I think we really should push for that also some more. All sorts of public peer review, and it's really more and better information especially. And again, for the benefit of both science primarily, we should care about science, of course, in the first place, but for society. And then in the end, essentially, it was really sort of this experience of whether you call it determinator or whatever, but I think if you are convinced of something that it's worthwhile to try, then really also think big. If others say, this will never go or so, well, you'll find out in the end, and just go for it and do it yourself. And there actually I really also have to give another special thanks to Arne Richter, because I think without his support this would never have worked. You have to find partners, of course, and of course the entire team with Thomas and the executive committee and Paul Krutzen and the many co-editors. So you need to build a team, but simply to learn, yes, just if you believe in something, then go for it and do it yourself. So there I really give some special thanks to Arne Richter again. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and hope that we can talk some more afterwards. If there are any immediate questions, I'll be happy to answer them, but we could also go on just in conversation later on. So thank you.
Yeah, Uli, thank you very much and congratulations again. You are now all invited to join us for a buffet, a dinner buffet, and of course some more drinks. This will be ready in some minutes, but we can already start asking questions to Uli down at the floor, or just to celebrate him. So we wish all of you a very nice evening. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much for joining us and honoring this great guy here. Okay, thank you very much.